szurkolás közepette se feledkezzenek meg a maszk használatról és a közösségi távolságtartásról.
Szurkolatőr, povtevő maszk és a distanc szociál, s'il vous plaît. Queridos espectadores, les pedimos amablemente que usen sus mascarillas y mantengan la distancia social. Дорогие зрители, напоминаем, что необходимо носить маски. И просим вас, соблюдайте социальную дистанцию, пожалуйста. International Judo Federation, Hungarian Judo Association, from all the sponsors and supporters, welcome to the final block of the first day of World Judo Championships, Hungary 2021.
Hölgyeim és uraim, a Nemzetközi Judo Szövetség, a Magyar Judo Szövetség és minden szponzor nevében nagy szeretettel köszöntünk mindenkit itt a 2021. évi magyarországi judo világbajnokság első napjának érmes mérkőzései.
Welcome to Budapest and to this 2021 World Judo Championships. Best known for its 19th century architecture wonders that go all the way along the River Danube, Budapest once again is playing host to a major global event. Now, with a huge entry which we've had here, over 668 fighters, the very top fighters are here to prepare for battle. One or two missing, but only one or two. Now, we've got the lightest weight categories first, just about to happen. And we've got the all medal matches, in fact, bronze and then gold medal matches. And joining me in the commentary position, of course, is Sheldon Franco Rooks. Sheldon, welcome.
Good afternoon, Neil, and good afternoon to everyone at home. Thanks also to our crew here who are bringing us these amazing pictures. And there is the best one yet. The two finalists, well, you can see one of them there, Tsunoda Natsumi of Japan. This is the one of the finalists in the under 48 kilo category, and there is her opponent, teammate Koga Wakana.
Yeah, I mean, Koga is the junior world champion, and here she is. I mean, and they're out there as if it's just a discussion. I mean, should be great. What a final.
Well, let's have a look at how they got here. As far as the bronze medal contest are concerned, we'll come back to the finalists. But let's have a look at the first of the bronze medal contests. Kelsey Parafan of Argentina goes up against Yulia Figueroa of Spain.
Yeah, what a run through she's had, Parafan. I mean, really, I've been watching her all day, and she's been doing amazingly. Figueroa's also had a great day as well, but Parafan has had several fights right the way through, and didn't come unstuck until the semi-final stages. But anyway, I thought we were going to get a run through of all the fights that we were, you know what I mean? But I'm sure that we're going to catch those a little bit later.
We were talking earlier about the possibility that Parafan was in some serious training with teammate and the current Olympic champion. Here's a first look at the contest with the Korean early on.
Well, that's Ianagi has been working all day for her. Sometimes she doesn't connect completely with it, but then all of a sudden hips pop across and then it happens.
Katarina Costa was next up for her. She came through round three on the back of a Wazari.
Yeah, I mean, Costa was so much more experienced. It was quite a tight match, this one. And they had to work very hard on it. A couple of penalties handed out because of the sleeves, but in the end, she pops it. Sodi Surakomi underneath, over the top she went.
Yeah, it's a good point. If she just hangs onto it for a little bit too long, it can look negative. But as she unloads, I mean, it really does look good. Came up against the unseeded Tsunoda Natsumi in the quarterfinal.
Tsunoda was absolutely on blistering form all day, what can I say?
And then she lost that and went into the repechage and had to face Laura Martinez Abelenda of Spain. Not always that easy to come back after, you know, a loss like that, but...
Yeah, well, again, like I say, she didn't connect every time, but in the end, I mean, she gets a Wazari first of all, and then finishes it off with that. Sodi Surakomigoshi right the way between the legs, and she was fighting for a bronze medal. Brilliant stuff. Great day.
So that's how Casey Parafan got here. Let's take a look now at her opponent, and that is Yulia Figueroa of Spain. First round. Round two, she had a bye in the first round. Second round win against Aisha Gabanli of Azerbaijan by Ippon. Neil Adams, talk us through that particular Ippon.
Well, I mean, like I say, just so experienced. And again, you know, just looking for the... you can see that it's an unusual... that was a Wazari, that particular one there. Catching them as they come up or out of the mat, and as they came up, she took a bat for a Wazari, then held for 10 seconds to make it Wazeti Ippon. Good transition, and of course the transition is what we're going to be looking for in our next group of matches.
Next opponent up was Brilit Gamara Carabayal of Peru. Another Ippon win, this in round three.
Well, Sodi Guruma Jimmy, and no escaping Sodi Guruma Jimmy when they get that on there, and she had to submit. One leg trapped, so experienced though. I mean, she really is. Great Newaza, again wins through.
And then a really tough contest in a quarterfinal against another seeded player, Shireen Boucli of France, who herself has been going great guns.
Yeah, I mean, Boucli has had a great run through in the Grand Prix, Grand Slams, and you can see here, right against left, Kosoto, and she gets a Wazari for that. It was a rolling Kosoto. But look at that transition, always looking for the transition, but that Wazari was enough to take her through.
Right, okay, so that's how the two contestants got here. We're looking forward to the action. The referee in the middle for this one is Orlando Cruz of the Dominican Republic.
I always say, Sheldon, that it just gives just that little bit of an edge, doesn't it? A lot of these fighters are fighting each other day in, day out at the Grand Prix, Grand Slams. But when you've got a world championship medal on the end of it, it kind of puts a different taste to it. and of course, the entry in and the whole build up to it as well. And it can make such a difference. And there's the tunnel. And I talk about the tunnel syndrome and what the nonsense sometimes you speak to your coach on the way out. And he's trying to relax you there and tell you different things. I remember talking about garden gnomes one time when we're on the way out. But I'm sure they're not talking about garden gnomes here.
Well, quite unusually, we've got the fighters coming in from different ends. They normally come in, you know, the same tunnel. They've got them lined up the side. A little bit more dramatic, I think, the entrance this time around. One coming from the left and one coming from the right. Anyway, they're both going to end up in the same place. And any second now, we'll be underway with the first of the medal matches in the under 48 kilo category. Casey Perafin of Argentina in the white judogi, Julia Figueroa in blue.
Well, Perafin, I think, will start with the Cienagi, and she does the Sodi as well, and doesn't always get great turn on it, but then she gets better and better as she goes. But of course, Figueroa, very experienced, and should be a good match. Uchimata. Look at the transition in, and straight away there, looking for the Newaza. She'll go one way and hitting both sides here. And straight away, Perafin is in a little bit of trouble.
Just managed to stay, you know, in between the legs and keep the roll from being executed on her there.
Yeah, the thing is, if you react, then you go over. Good change of direction there from Figueroa. There she is again. If she reacts, starts to come up, that's the danger. And that's going to go over. This is going to happen, I think. It's going to go again. She might change the direction one more time. And then she's going to tie up the top half and into the hold.
Yeah, we saw that with the first attempt there. She just managed to stay between the legs and keep the pressure off. This time, couldn't manage to do it. Good turn from Figueroa.
Well, she had a Wazari on the board there. Just needed to hold for the 10 seconds to make it Wazari a Wazeti Ipon. And Figueroa of Spain wins the first medals of this championships. Under 48 kilos category, and that was a nice bit of Newaza. She looked threatening, didn't she, when she was down there the first time, and she points to the back patch there. I'm from Spain, we all know she is, but what a brilliant performance that was. Great transition, always love to see the transition from standing down to ground.
Well, first ever world medal for Figueroa. No wonder she's delighted. I mean, we've got all of the other things that are going to go with it. A really good feeling about where she's likely, or if she's likely to be seeded when she goes to Tokyo. But the first thing for her to be looking at here is enjoying the fact that she's now got a world championship medal.
Well, she got a Wazari for that, and the Wazari was simply because it was continuous and controlled with the hands. There was the turn. Pity we didn't see the whole turn, but it was... here we go. and round the waist onto the belt and secures the upper part of the body. Brilliant control from Figueroa. Controls the head as well. And there's coach there. Says that's nothing... less than I expected. Brilliant stuff there from Figueroa, bronze medalist at the World Championships.
Well, happy days for the bronze medal winner. Remember, we've still got the the big final to come. Tsunoda Natsumi is waiting for her turn. Just having the judogi checked. That's a normal procedure for every contest that they go through.
Yeah, I don't think a lot of people realize that you have to go through all of this. Of course, your jacket has to be a certain percentage in the sleeves and in the back. It has to cross over properly. The trousers have to be the correct length and also thickness of material as well, which is imperative. I mean, if the material's too thick, impossible to grip, of course. So here we go, second bronze medal match then, and Mungbat Urantseg is up against Istria Krasniki, and it's going to be an absolute belter. Number four in the world against the number one world-ranked fighter.
There's a look at the former world champion, Mungbat Urantseg. As Neil said, started off the day as the number four seed here, opened up with Oh Yeonju of the Republic of Korea in her round two contest. Won that by Ippon. Let's have a look and see how that took place.
Yeah, she went straight into round two. All the top seeds go straight into round two. Straight off the seats, great Kosoto there. And as always, the transition, superb. And of course, she has several things she can do from this position. The Sangaku, she can go onto the arm here. And she's relentless with it here. You can see absolutely the wrong place for her opponent to be there. She turns up for the Sangaku. She gets into this position, turns into the hold down, and it's game over. Gets the submission as well.
Clinical finish, wasn't it? Really nice and tight, sharp there. And then not the first time these two have gone head to head. Urantseg Galbadrak, Kazakh, formerly of Mongolia, that was next up.
And they were formerly number two, weren't they? One and two in Mongolia.
But that was a measure of just how tight things were. It ended just on the penalties. Unfortunately, and they knew each other, or they know each other
so well. Yeah.
It wasn't quite the case when they came to the quarterfinal, however, because Mungbat went over to the eventual finalist, Koga Wakana. Anyway, she bounced back in the repechage contest, did Mungbat, came up against Shireen Boukli of France. That is not an easy fight at all.
No, well, Boukli is the one, isn't she? She's been on form. She's been performing well at all the Grand Prix, Grand Slams. But look at that.
Incredible with the sleeve. Kataguruma with the sleeve.
Kataguruma, yeah. And it was almost a reverse Kataguruma to take her over for the Wazari. And here she is fighting for bronze against this lady here. And
well, I think... that was a look at Mungbat's route to the bronze medal contest. Let's have a look and see how it was that Istria Krasniki made out, because she had a bye in the first round as the number one seed. Just a few of the players were able to get a bye into round two. She came up against the home favourite, Chernovitsky Eva of Hungary, and unfortunately Chernovitsky had an injury in her opening contest that she won, actually, but picked up an injury and wasn't able to compete. So that was a bit of a letdown for the crowd, but possibly not so much for Krasniqi, who moved smoothly into round three.
Yeah, you say that, she certainly struggled in this against Sabina
Galiazova. Yeah, they went into the golden score, didn't they?
Yeah, she just had a job to really get going in it, and I think it's because she hadn't had mat time. You know, so it was good in one way, but it was a really, really hard fought match, this was. In the end, it went into golden score, and it was that particular movement there and she managed to go through to fight for third place. Just a Wazari.
Next up was the quarterfinal against Laura Martinez of Spain. I think she'd warmed up by now.
Yeah, definitely a better match, this one, for Krasniqi.
This is Giliazova, again, just having another look at... it was tired going in from Giliazova, the attack,
yeah.
And it was tired going down from Krasniqi. You could see it on her face.
No, it was hard. It was a hard, hard match.
There is the semi-final. This is where it all came unstuck for the number one seed, losing out there. And now we've got lined up against Munkbat Urdencetig of Mongolia. Here is the contest with Martinez. Lovely Uchi Mata.
Yeah, one was Ari before that as well, and she just took her apart. It was a really clinical performance.
Needs to dig deep here.
I think so, because, you know, you come in as favourite. She was a favourite, and you've got to say that. Not a clear favourite, but she was. But here she's got a really tough match up against Munkbat Urdencetig, and Urdencetig is going to be trying to take it to ground whenever she can.
Referee in the middle for this one is Ramziddin Saidov of Uzbekistan. She's been a terrific representative for Mongolia over the years, really has, Munkbat.
She had a period where she was quite almost unbeatable, or looked almost unbeatable, didn't she? And then, of course, what happens is people start to catch up. They're looking at your videos all the time. It gets more and more difficult to be superior in the weight. People do catch you up. Then you lose the odd fight. But she is, like you said, one of these dig-in people, and she's dug in there, and she's still up there roundabout and fighting for third place at the Worlds. Krasniqi, she has performed so well in the last 6 months, and she's got to really take the fight to Munkbat. Here we go. Munkbat in white, Krasniqi in blue, and for the non-judoka out there, it's all about throwing onto the back with impetus, with force. That'll finish it off, give them a nip on. You can hold down for 20 seconds. Without any contact with the legs, arm lock or strangle for a submission. Well, it shows you how hard this match is going to be, because I can tell you now that Munkbat doesn't wince at many things. She's a hard nut.
Really good matchup this, because they've got completely different styles. I like Krasniqi's attacking, especially the Uchi Mata. You know, you've got to be big and brave to launch one of those, especially against someone like Munkbat, who enjoys that close contact, almost wrestling-style fighting, if you like.
Which is so typical, isn't it, of the Mongolians right the way through, men and women. But, you know, the thing is with Krasniqi, she is physically as strong as well as Munkbat, and I'd say that that's going to be a big advantage here for her. But so far, she's just falling behind on attacks. Munkbat is the one that's initiating.
Both of these have had a run at 52 kilos as well from time to time, and both with some degree of success. They haven't struggled when they've gone up.
No, they've been winning medals, haven't they? Yeah. You know, at the higher weight as well. But winning tournaments is a different thing, isn't it? It can be a different thing, winning the tournaments. And so both of these having more success at the lower weight category.
Krasniqi, I think it would be fair to say, decided on the under 48 kilo category, not least of all because of the presence of Malinda Kelmendi at the weight higher up at 52.
Well, yeah, and now, of course, there's so many, isn't there, at under 52 that have come up just recently. There's quite a few contenders. I think for the Olympics, of course, it's going to be a different situation, but youngsters coming through.
After contest gone, no score as yet. Nice clean contest sheet at the moment. No penalties picked up by either fighter.
No, I think it's positive, isn't it? They're both of them with a positive mindset here. Let's go forward. Let's grip up. Let's get it on.
Ooh, having said that, I shouldn't have said anything. Munkbat picks up a penalty just for avoiding to take a grip there.
Yeah, again, for the non-judoka, the little yellow thing that you can see up there on the scoreboard, three of those and it's all over, and the other person wins by default. But you get them not attacking at certain times. You can step outside of the yellow area. You've got to stay within that. And if you don't attack enough, you can get it. So small things, and they accumulate quickly.
As Nikki beginning to step up the tempo here a little bit, shaping with a few attacks. We haven't seen the Uchimata yet. Normally sets it up with that right Ojigari, and when her opponents are stepping off,
yeah, I think just, well, I was going to say, just like, you know, with Monkbat, she doesn't want to go down to ground with her. And I think Monkbat's saying, you're not going to get close for the Uchimata. You're not even going to get anywhere near it. We were talking about it, weren't we, just then with Dennis van der Geest. We were saying that stiff arms, you know, if you've got your stiff arms with your hands in a certain position, then you're blocking out. But so you can have stiff arms to keep the partner out so that you can attack, you know, get a little bit of space. I think that's what these two are doing. You know, they're trying to be defensive, but attacking is what they're after, really. That's the main thing.
That's Nikki looking to go up and around the collar. Monkbat deciding to give some space between her and her opponent. Doesn't want to get too close. Not unless she's doing the controlling.
First 4 minutes gone, and so if no score on the board, and I'm not talking about penalties, then it goes into a golden score. And other than penalties being accumulated, three, remember, then any score now will win the contest. So any throw, hold down for 10 seconds, arm lock or strangle for a submission, and it's all over.
Just thinking that Monkbat looks a slight bit defensive, a little bit more defensive than Krasniqi, and maybe that's because she trails in the head-to-head, 2-1.
So they had some battles before then, Sheldon.
Krasniqi's fought the coach.
I hope not while she's been on the mat.
No, she's beaten the current Mongolian coach. She's defeated her previously. That was way back in 2016 at the back end of Monkbat's career. That's who's sitting in the coach's chair.
See, this is the kind of information that you have, isn't it?
Well, only because I've got my laptop out.
Coming up to 1 minute. Well, it's just gone over 1 minute, should I say. Anybody's match, this, and she'll have to attack off that, Monkbat. She's tying up the arm to do the Sodi Surakomigoshi on the opposite side.
I think that's unfortunate that she's picked up that penalty, because Monkbat wasn't really doing anything except pushing her to the edge.
No, she wasn't, and she was too long on the same side. Can't stay too long on the same side. That's a penalty waiting to happen.
Having said that, she did step out.
Yes, she did.
Krasniqi, so...
Yeah, you've got to stay within it. We haven't got any ring, have we? And we've got no ropes keeping us in.
Really wants to launch that Uchimata.
Yeah, she's killing that hand every time, Monkbat. Killing that sleeve, and you don't see that very often with Krasniqi. Look at that, looking for that that same kataguruma that she scored in the earlier rounds there, trying to pop the head through. We haven't seen one little bit of newaza from her, because obviously Krasniqi's kept
interested.
It tight.
Yeah.
Well, I really
close,
don't know which
it?
Way this
yeah,
is going to go.
Very close.
Yeah, it is really close.
I'd like to see Krasniqi trying for something other than just getting into the position for the Uchimata. She's got to look for something else.
Got to hit the other flank, and she has been doing it. Actually, she's got good ashiwaza over to the left leg.
Ooh,
now
slip.
Then, is that a mistake? Is she in the hold here? She's going to... Osai Komi and Monkbat, who's renowned for a newaza, just manages to grab the leg there. Second stop after a couple of seconds. It's got to be 10 seconds or more, and she's going to have to get up. So Monkbat, a little bit of a panic there.
Lots of advice coming from both chairs.
Yeah, the advice can only come from the chairs in the mate. They can't do it while they're actually fighting. You'll sometimes see them warned if they do it while they're fighting.
Monkbatar Bundmar in the chair for Monkbat, and Triton Kukar as ever for the Kosovans. Done an amazing job, hasn't he?
Well, he's done an amazing job. Every one of these Kosovan athletes come out really well prepared. They're physically prepared.
And different styles. Second penalty picked up by Monkbat.
Yeah, this, well, here we go. We've just seen it now. So one of the coaches just been told to...
It's Trent Kukar, he's been asked to watch from the stands now. So he's vacated his seat.
So he's out, yes.
Bundmar has kept herself quiet. He rather fancy staying in her chair.
Pressure on now for the third penalty here, Monkbat. She'll know that she's got to do all the attacks at the right time. Krasniqi here now will know to up the pace, just up the ante that little bit. There's the right arm. She's trying to get that on there. Look at the left arm of Monkbat. We're talking about the defensive one. I think that definitely was the defensive posture there. Oh, Osoto! Oh, that was close. Of course, she was in danger there of going over herself, wasn't she?
Monkbatar skating on thin ice here, the coach. Been warned again.
Well, I thought it was second warning and out. So, like you say, it is thin ice.
Just shading it for me now, Krasniqi. That's where you're looking for the score to come from now.
She needs to hit that front foot, and she's been doing it in other contests. Set up the Osoto, it'll set up the attack on the right-hand side.
Can't free the hands up, Krasniqi. Really trapped there, look.
Yeah, but she's not doing anything there. Krasniqi's staying there. It's all over. I tell you now, Monkbat's going to probably get it. I think it will be 1-1, penalty each, and that was really bad tactically from Monkbat.
Oh, just...
Well...
Krasniqi trying to con the referee there into thinking there wasn't anything that she could do, and I think that maybe she could have pulled the arm out. That's, otherwise, you have to penalise Monkbat for having trapped it and done nothing with the grip.
Yeah, no, exactly. Well, I thought they were going to go one-on-one and it was going to be all over.
Negative gripping from both of them. Well, it was just Krasniqi that got called for it. And now she really has to step up because Monkbat looks as though she's ready to roll the dice now. One more time, try and take it now. Doesn't want to go any further than 5 minutes into a golden score. Krasniqi still looks as though she's got something in the tank.
Yes, they always do, don't they? They just... Osoto! Osoto Gary, and just managed to put her elbow down. It was the elbow out that prevented the score. It's got to be the side. Side or side to back to get a score. And it was elbow out there from Monkbat.
Loretta Cusack-Doyle was saying earlier on about not getting trapped into, what we used to call the hand tie session, split decision. Here, this is a very similar thing. Don't go out on a third Shido. Go big. Take it now.
Take the chance. Absolutely. And she's going again here. Now she's starting to work, Krasniqi.
Again, the sleeve looks
and
trapped.
And look at that. She's got the sleeve again. And Krasniqi's holding the sleeve up. Well, this is 50-50 now.
Yeah.
You know, they've got to give it to one. Mm. Who are they going to give it to? I don't think I would have left it to a 50-50 chance that the referee's going to give it one way or the other. I don't get that.
That's nothing.
You know, for me, the first time I thought that Monkbat had held the arm across. Understood why they didn't give it. And this time, Krasniqi's hoping that that's the
that's
decision.
What see. I think that left hand of Monkbat, which is on the other side, you can't see that. That's pushing that across. That's keeping
well,
it.
Well, I
there.
Agree. I know she's done it twice. Yeah. I think she's going to get it. I think Monkbat's going to get it. I don't think that it's going to go against Krasniqi. Interesting, though, because, she's got it. So that's the second time they've read it like that. They're reading it differently to us.
For us. See, I don't think she puts the hand over there. And for me, that's a penalty. If you put the hand over there, that's a penalty. I think she's pushed that across with the arm, but rather stupidly, she's left it there trying to draw the referee's attention to it, and they're not seeing it that way.
That's what I was saying there, that she definitely left that to a 50-50 possibility. But they had to go for the first one. You know, they gave it the first time one way. So, that isn't the way to win, or lose.
Lose, yeah.
No, it's not. A world bronze medal.
Yeah, and she's not fought that well.
No, I did. She hasn't. And I think that to take the chance on a world bronze medal that the referee board will go one way or the other, I think that was a massive chance. I really do.
Well, congratulations to Mukhmet Uransetic then, who tactically fought the right fight. She got the decisions that went her way. Three penalties were picked up. And you see the left hand under there. That looks strong to me, keeping it on that side anyway.
I'm telling you, she's super strong, right? And so when she pushes an arm across. But anyway, that's an interesting one that we'll look at for a long time ahead.
We come now to the final of the under 48 kilo category. Tsunoda Natsumi of Japan faces Koga Wakana of Japan. All Japan head to head. It'll be Tsunoda in the white judogi, Koga in blue.
Yeah, I mean, we saw them both, didn't we, talking to each other out there. So this will be an interesting matchup. This lady here has been on absolute fire.
Both unseeded. When can you remember two unseeded fighters making it to the gold medal contest? Bye in the first round. Lucky for Tsunoda as an unseeded player to get a bye. Second round, one of the top Europeans, Milica Nikolic of Serbia. She defeated her by Ippon. That was in round two. Let's take a little look at that, Neil.
Yeah, I mean, I thought that she was going to have problems with Nikolic. She pulls Nikolic over, and she's straight onto the arm, and Nikolic, didn't stand up immediately, and it was too late then, because she just collapses her and straightens the arm.
Doesn't
beautiful.
Even need the roll, does she?
No,
she's
she
already
didn't
on.
Need the roll. She was attacking so hard onto the arm and then takes the head away. And you'll notice the same here against Melanie Clement.
Number four seed, Melanie Clement of France. She also fell to Tsunoda Natsumi. This was in round three.
Well, same situation, exactly the same situation here. This time, though, she starts to do a roll underneath to collapse Clement, and then she has to readjust the balance there in order to put the juji on, and she applies it face down.
Two juges
back to back.
Where she hasn't had to have the full power of the legs across, roll, everything,
No, the reason is, though, that she's attacking the arm and the elbow immediately and controlling the head. Watch this one again, against Perifan. In control, underneath, looking for the turnover, you'd think so, but then she changes it to the juji. She goes onto the arm, and the arm's already straight there. So she does the roll from underneath. Yeah. She did it bang, bang, bang each match, and she didn't even break a sweat.
Semi-final contest, another Ippon win for Tsunoda, this time against the number one seed, Dystria Krasniqi.
Yeah, I mean, she had to resort to standing against Krasniqi. She really came alive, and the tomanagi she did is one from the kata. There's the first one, scores a wazari beautifully underneath, and you'll notice that if it's a left grip, it's left foot forward, so that's it's not a yoko tomanagi, it's right the way over the top. And she gets the second wazari.
Ends up using 2 feet. But what's beautiful about that is she follows it just in case there's not the score there, ready for the niwaza.
Absolutely.
There's a look at her opponent, the youngster Koga Wakana. We knew when we saw the two Japanese in the mix that there were going to be problems, and they certainly caused them right from the get-go. Round one, Koga Wakana was up against her opponent from Tajikistan, Shukrona Kachieva.
Well, the junior world champion, again, great with the transition and just attacking in Newaza positions. And the Japanese, just this ladies team, just renowned for it, just climbs around that leg as if it's nothing. Ties up the top half there, and there she is, Yoko Shiogatami, or Kazure, but anyway, then turns it into Kazure Kasagatami. Brilliant Newaza, as always. Thing for me is they're not scared to attack.
Second round win was against one of the top eight seeds, Marusa Stanger of Slovenia. Also by a win by Ippon. Well, it was a third penalty actually that brought her that. Stanger not able to come up with anything apart from the three penalties. That was unfortunate. Well, next up was Francesca Milani of Italy, round three.
Yeah, Milani's been having a really good run as well. Fairly new on the scene and doing well in the Grand Prix and Grand Slams. But again, Newaza position and looking for the Shimiwaza here. And the thing is, never stopping here. And the referee, of course, good position just to see it there. Underneath the neck, manages to get the submission.
Yeah, Turbatan Setseg, the referee, overseeing things there. And then in the quarterfinal, it was Koga up against Munkbat Duran Setseg of Mongolia.
She does well against super strong Mongolian and just catches her with this Osoto there. Drops down first of all and just catches the foot. Beautifully taken Osoto there and plop on her back.
Semi-final contest was against Julia Figueroa of Spain.
Well, we just saw Figueroa win a bronze medal. Same Osoto there, takes Figueroa over for a lovely Wazari. And that put her through. Great performance from the junior world champion.
And that brings us neatly to our final then. Well, we know the destination of the gold medal. We've got two Japanese here. Which one is going to take it? We've had, we've already had Tsunoda winning a world championship medal. She was a silver medalist here back in 2017 at under 52 kilos. Has since come down a weight. Let's see how she copes here in her second world championship final. The referee in the middle for this one is Vladimir Notsubidze of Georgia.
Well, you've got to also realize that the number one Japanese is at home waiting for the Olympic Games to happen. The world number ones or the Japanese selection are not here, actually, for this World Championships. And, wow, what depth they have in the under 48 kilograms. This lady here has had an amazing day and she'll be hoping that it continues here, full of confidence and great tachiwaza, great newaza. Junior world champion, everything to prove. Can she win a senior world title at such a young age?
No coaches required for this one.
No, it's interesting, isn't it? No coaches needed out there. They're out on their own. They literally are out on their own. I remember as coaches, we used to sometimes put fighters out there so that they get used to fighting on their own, because if you rely on coaches shouting at you all the time, it's not always a good thing.
They're always talking about one of the other fighters who's been selected for the Olympic Games being ahead of these two. That's Tanaki Funa. There is even another one, Kondo Ami, who is higher than both of these.
Wow.
Now this really, you could be looking at the number 3 and 4 in Japan.
Straight into the attack there, wasn't she, Koga? And then looking for the Tominagi there, Sanada.
It's always interesting to see which one of the pair is more interested in engaging in the Niwaza. It could be that Koga's just as interested, but that wasn't her opportunity. We shall see.
Yeah, I mean, as a Niwaza person, I like to attack in Niwaza, but I didn't like it if it wasn't a position that I liked, you know. Yeah. So
you'd just then be up and out.
Yeah, and if they were attacking me, I didn't like it at all. Oh, look at that. Wazari scored.
Just
Tominagi.
Squeezed that one out, didn't she?
Yeah, it was one of those straight underneath there, and just takes her onto a side. It was side to front, but it was still side.
Yep. Okay.
Got to look at the points of contact. Two Wazaris, of course, finish it. Ippon finishes it straight off. Well, both of them get a Shido for not gripping up. So you can't play pitter-patter out there. You've got to grip up. You've got to attack. Remember, the main aim is to score an Ippon. Three ways in Niwaza, in groundwork, to score an Ippon, and one in standing. Although there's a lot of different variations of throws. Some sacrifice and some direct, some throwing to the front where you've got to turn your back to your opponent, some throwing your opponent to the back. So lots of different directions. Somebody's going to get a second penalty here, and it's going to be Sanada.
Sanada, yeah.
Yeah, and she gets it for pinning the sleeve and not attacking.
Well, there's plenty of time left on the clock. Can't afford another error.
No, that'd be tragic. I mean, it really would be a tragic way to go, that would, just for the sake of not attacking. They're both a little bit cautious of each other. Now she's into Niwaza. And I know that Koga won't want to be down here because she'll know that she's superior in Niwaza. Sonada onto the arm immediately.
Almost 10 years senior is Tsunoda. So In this weight category in Japan, you're looking at the back end, really, of a career. Koga at 19, just really getting underway.
Yeah, we see it so often, don't we, that the junior world champion... Oh, Sianagi there. That was close as well. And we see it so often that junior world champion comes through, and then they go through into the men. They'll pick up a bronze the odd time, and then they'll go on to become senior world champion. It happens a lot.
Good strong attack from Tsunoda there. Gives her another 20 odd seconds to, you know, play around with the grips and move around. You have to keep attacking, and then you get a certain amount of time before the next one. I like to refer to them as cycles.
I think she's she knows this danger here as well with this fighter here. And she obviously, Randa is with her as well. And she's pinning that sleeve again. Mm. Got to be very careful with that. Good, that is a Niwaza one.
Yeah,
That is from Niwaza.
From
Niwaza.
She was already on the ground. Yeah.
Is she on the arm? She's on that arm, I think. She's going to come back into it. She'll roll back in here and try and get her head out, and then she'll put pressure on that head. She's got to get her head out to put that on properly. Possibility here, and the referee, I hope he lets it carry on. Oh, well, he stops it. She was on the arm there.
half a minute left to go. And then we'll have a look at something. Not sure what it is that Vladimir Nutsubidze wants to look at.
Yeah, well, I'm not sure whether it was the pinning of the arm or whether it was the movement there. That, for me, that was Newaza.
Interesting. If Tsunoda was still standing up, and they may be looking at that as a possible throw, I wonder.
Yeah, they'll
they look as though he's ready to. Yeah, they want to give another score. Yeah. So we're lucky actually to have Neil along with us, because we are going to see that as a replay. Now, we've only seen it once, well, just that second time there. But this time around, we'll be able to look specifically to see where Koga was and where Tsunoda Natsumi was. And if they feel that she was still in the standing up position, then they can consider it as for Tachiwaza purposes. If they feel that both were in Neiwaza, then it's just a turnover. We'll have a look.
Yeah, here. No, you're right. And the thing is as well, she might be just starting to come up. Mm. And so we're going to see the movement. Well, that's the first Wazari there with the Tominagi. Scored a lot from that Tominagi all the way through. Well, certainly against Krasniki. See how far she goes between the legs when she does that, when she executes that. And yeah, she's still, well, is she? Well, yes, both the elbows didn't go on the floor. Yeah. So that's what they were looking at there, to see if both the elbows touch the floor. See it from a different angle this time. Not quite. So if the elbows had touched the floor, it would definitely be Newaza, because then it'll be just take the elbows back up. But, well, I don't know. Seeing it from that angle there, I'm not quite not so sure.
Yeah, for me, the first look was I thought that that was an action that could be counted as a turnover in Newaza. Yeah. But then, you know, the more I look at it, I see what they're looking at, which is Tsunoda hasn't gone to ground, Koga has. And she's still got the possibility for executing a Tachiwaza technique. Okay, well, that's how that one turned out. Gold medal to Tsunoda Natsumi of Japan. It's taken a while in coming for her.
Ip on every match, Sheldon. Amazing.
She really has looked good. Right, so we're into the warm-up area again to look at the final. And it's one that I could not have picked up this morning. Guzman Kyrgyzbaev of Kazakhstan will go up against his RJF opponent, Yago Aboladze. Looks nice and cool there, doesn't he? Sitting back, just chilling.
Yeah, he does. He's had an amazing run through, Aboladze, and, Kyrgyzbaev as well. I mean, he's had a great run through, beating and defeating Kaya in the semi-final. But, you wouldn't have seen this, and you wouldn't have written it down at the beginning.
Before we get that far, we've got the first of the bronze medal contest. Karamat Huseynov of Azerbaijan goes up against Magzan Shamshadin, also from Kazakhstan. Let's have a look at how they've got this far.
Well, we've got Huseynov there. We're going to have a look at his little run through, how he got there.
Yeah, his first round opponent was Mohamed Rashadazad, representing the International Judo Federation refugee team.
Yeah, great. Look at that. Yoko Otoshi there. Just beautifully executed. It was more of a roll, but enough to take him through.
Round two, he came up against Nikolai Focha of Moldova.
There's one thing watching the dropping techniques, but when you see them explode in and then start to come up as well, that's what makes them. Look at that, Kosoto. Beautiful. All his techniques going off to the side. Beautifully executed.
And here was the biggest upset of the day. Hussainov, it was, who put out the number one seed, world number one, Nagayama Ryuji of Japan.
Yeah, and there are a few people crying for the Ippon here, saying, I think that warrants it. I think it took a couple of times looking at the landing, but anyway, taking out the firm favourite there. Big mistake.
Unfortunately, he wasn't able to keep it going. He came up against Walid Kaya, missed out there, but he had to bounce back in the repechage contest, and he did that against Flagfajants of Mongolia.
Yeah, seeing Aggie. It was one of those scores that you have to look at twice, but it was enough to take him through. So he's fighting for third place, and he's had a great run through.
Well, there's his opponent, Maksan Shamshadin of Kazakhstan, and this is his route to the bronze medal contest. First round bye, lucky for him. As I say, unseeded players don't often get the benefit of a first round bye. It was the case for Shamshadin. His second round contest was, I think, if I'm not mistaken, that's Artem Lesyuk of Ukraine. So it is.
Yeah, beautifully executed that was, but he was just absolutely taking people out. He really was.
And in a tough third round battle against Jure Verstraeten of Belgium, you'd have put some money on the Belgian there.
Yeah, it was a hard match, but he never going again. Verstraeten just never quite got going. Got countered for the tip, what I call the tip.
The tip, yeah.
And yeah, it was enough. He just rolled him onto his side.
Put him into the quarterfinal, where he faced the number two seed, Francisco Garrigos of Spain.
Garrigos had to fight hard in a lot of his contests, came back a couple of times, but this was the deciding one. It was two landings there, so just gets the Wazari, but that was enough to take him through.
Yeah, at which point, you know, we were thinking about a possible all-Kazakh final. Didn't work out. Lost his semi-final. That brought him down into this bronze medal contest. And now, here we are then. Jean-Claude Jimbi of Gabon is the referee in the middle for this one. It's the second of the bronze medal contests. Beg your pardon, it's the first. We've had two for the women, and now we have the first for the men. Karamat Hussainov of Azerbaijan goes up against Maksan Shamshadin of Kazakhstan.
And trying not to make him too nervous, but also trying to give him some directives.
Well,
it's got to be positive.
Don't mention anything about garden gnomes. That
well,
didn't
do you know
help.
What? Well, it took my mind off it for a split second, but yeah.
There he is. He's coming out there on his own, isn't he? Look.
Yeah, so...
looks like a super lightweight boxer, doesn't he? Just jogging in and throwing a few shadow punches there. Totally relaxed.
You know what? It's funny, but I'm just watching him come out there and running out, and I thought, I could never do that. I had a job to walk out. Legs were going, legs were like jelly. Here they go. Fighting for third place here at the World Championships, under 60 kilograms. Zainov in white, Shamshadin of Kazakhstan in blue. Again, just wrapping up the sleeves there, the end of the sleeves. They will get penalized if they just keep them down, but certainly Hussainov, two attacks up already. Good attacks as well.
if he's clever here, go back to the feet one more, and Shamshedin will be passive. He didn't have to.
No, and for me, for sure, it's got to be Shamshedin.
Yeah, I mean, he's given away that for no reason at all, Shamshedin there. You've got to have that clock in your head that tells you, well, look, you know, Huseynov's already gone in there twice. I haven't even flexed a muscle yet.
And two good attacks as well.
That was strong enough.
Yeah.
And now you're a Shido down. You may come to rue that come the end of the contest if, you know, if it goes that to that kind of matchup at the end. Don't want to be giving away unnecessary penalties.
Wow, that was a little bit hairy there. Zainov came in for a technique. He came off the wrong side.
Almost was on the end.
He could have been loaded up there, couldn't he? Wow.
I've stolen this term from tennis. It's called unforced errors. And for me, Shamshedin has already committed an unforced error. He didn't need to give up that Shido.
No, well, exactly. And, well, we saw that, didn't we, in the bronze medal fight there in the under 48 kilograms. Mm. I mean, it's an unnecessary chance taking.
Half the contest still to come. Huseynov looking reasonably solid on his feet. Just for that one little flash there when he was out of position and was almost on Shamshedin's back. Immediate halt to proceedings there as Huseynov apologised for having caught Shamshedin on the lip. Just shows what's really inside when they immediately, there's no malice in there at all.
None at all, but it's hard, isn't it?
Oh,
and that's the key point here. It's hard, it's a hard match. The gripping's always going to be hard. And there you see up in the crowd there, the
on the
Aziri,
right.
Yeah, absolutely.
The top man. Yeah, just a little bit over enthusiastic from the coach there. Minute and a half left to go.
Yeah, Shamshedin hasn't really been able to get an attack in. Here we are. I don't think we've seen him do something that you thought possibility of a score. And there's half a one. Got all the way in that time and now starting to open up a little bit.
I just have the feeling that that suits Huseynov. He just wants him to open up that little bit so he can drop underneath. And at the moment, Shamshedin has been that little bit too tight. On the two occasions that Huseynov has gone in, they've been good attacks, but they haven't been really threatening. This time when he opened up, it looked a little better for Huseynov.
Oh, look. Osodagari this time. Wow, it's really opened up now. Great attacking from both these fighters. This is what we want to see.
Still just a single Shido against Shamshedin. It hasn't hurt him yet.
No, they're both of them. They've opened up a little bit. They're willing to have a go. Drop underneath. And I said actually earlier that today has been, I mean, quite often you see a lot of techniques going off to the side, but they've been dropping underneath and coming back up out of it all day in this under 60 kilos category. It's been good.
That's a nice Sodi Surikami, almost the counter.
Yeah, they're both both going for the Sodi Surikami, weren't they? Both off the sleeve. First 4 minutes gone then, and now into the golden score. Certainly started to liven up this match.
Huseynov has gone into the golden score without having picked up a penalty. That's really good on his part. Almost gets caught. Not sure why Shamshedin is celebrating here.
No, it was kind of half hope, wasn't it? He landed on his front, no score given, and quite rightly so too.
Yeah, he felt that coming. Good defense, good turn off it.
Yeah, great change of direction there from Shamshedin. Shows How dangerous he is.
Stepping it up now. Pendulum is beginning to swing here. Penalty now to Huseynov. Two unanswered attacks from the Kazakh fighter. Huseynov has got to start looking to sharpen up now.
Both on the sleeves again. They've got to go in, have to do something. Can't afford a second one. Oh, tries the Kosoto, almost gets countered backwards. And it was Shamshidin that did it.
Well, they're going to take a look at this for a possible score. There's the Kosoto that Neil was talking about.
Good call there from the referee. That might be a landing there that gives a score.
Huseynov thought it was Wazari. He's calling it on the ground. You can see it. Yep, he's going to get it. Yep.
Just gets the landing there. Side to front. But anyway, that... is a good score, and it means that he wins the bronze medal.
Well, we saw enough today from Karamat Huseynov, for me anyway, to say he's taken a well-deserved bronze medal. I don't like to throw that phrase out there. You hear it so often. But he has worked hard today. And the other thing is, He's knocked out the number one seed, the world number one, Nagayama Ryuju. You know, he had one slip against Walid Kaya, and then he's come back, repechage contest, now in this bronze medal contest. I think he's done well.
He had a great day, you know, and he'll reflect on it. I'm sure he will, thinking, I could have won that. it's like that, isn't it? I mean, sometimes it's possible, sometimes perhaps not quite so possible. So that counter there, his big advantage, of course, massive advantage, was that he had the sleeve. He had the sleeve. And he kept control of the sleeve all the way down to ground.
Well, we've got another bronze medal contest coming up for you shortly. But before that, what are the two finalists doing then? Let's have a look. Back of house and see how they are preparing for their upcoming final. There is Guzman Kyrgyzbaev just having his judogi check. Neil was mentioning earlier everything that has to be checked, made sure that it's all in good order. And there is Yago Abuladze getting ready.
Do you know, that's sometimes the most, it's terrifying. You know, oh, I've got one fight still left, and then it's game on, you know. Pretty terrifying.
Yep, he likes the look of that. Everything's in order. Right, we come now to the second of the bronze medal contest. Francisco Garrigós of Spain goes up against Walid Kaya of France. It'll be Garrigós in the white judogi, Kaya in blue. There is the head-to-heads. Garrigós leads the series 2-1. Let's have a look at how they got here.
I think both of these guys will be kind of disappointed that it isn't one step further. You know, they expect a little bit more. Let's have a little look at see how we got to this stage.
By in round one, and then against Miraç Akos of Turkey.
Loves his newaza, has great transition, and follows through and just turns it into the arm and straight onto the juji there. Brilliant bit of newaza there.
Round three, he came up against Matam Kokolaev of Israel, and it was Kokolaev had put out Koga Genki in the previous round. He was looking good.
as all the Israelis are, you know, just well prepared and strong, just getting stronger and stronger. But again, he just ties up the top half here, and I said when I was watching it and commentating it, he's just going to take that leg out, and it's going to be all over. Exactly what happened.
Put the squeeze
great
on.
Great bit of newaza. Former junior world champion, Gary Goss.
Yeah, and then after that, he came unstuck against Magzan Shamshidin. Down into the repechage, he came up against Yanislav Gurchev of Bulgaria.
Tominagi, Yoko Tominagi, and scores, there was Ari. And I said earlier as well that he just is a workhorse, this man. Just keeps at it all the time. And that's what you're going to get here in this bronze medal match. He won't stop coming forwards. Let's have a little look, see how his opponent got there for this bronze medal match here.
Walid Kaya was one of the top eight seeds, eight if I'm not mistaken, first round by, and the second round win over Joshua Katz of Australia. Katz it was who picked up three penalties, not able to make any headway against the Frenchman, and unfortunately for him, going out with three penalties. Well, next up was Issam Bassou of Morocco.
Yeah, this ended up with Ippon, big arm over the back, grabs the belt, and look at that. Sumagej gets the wazari, and then straight in for the shimiwaza. Switches it to the arm and gets the submission. Again, transition winning through. Nice balance.
And then he had to face Karamat Huseynov, conqueror of Nagayama Ryuju. Well, Huseynov by then had not gone off the boil, but he found it very difficult. And he ended up picking up three penalties and gifting the contest, really, to Walid Kaya. That put him in the semi-final, where he lost out to Guzman Kyrgyzbaev, and that's put him down into this bronze medal contest.
Yeah.
So getting ready for that now is the referee in the middle, Mariano Dos Santos. And with commentary on this medal match here is Neil Adams.
Well, you have to get, if you get to semi-final, then you, if you lose it, you come back down for an immediate bronze medal fight. If you get to quarter-final, then you have to do a repechage extra fight to get to meet the loser from the opposite side of your draw. I think they'll both have something to prove here. They'll want to finish the long day with a bronze medal at the World Championships. So many of these fighters are going to be going to the Olympic Games. Two cracks of the whip, all within a month. Here's Kaya. What a great day he's had as well. Garrigós in white, Kaya in blue. Well, I suspect that Garrigós is going to want to transition down into ground whenever he can. Tries the Tominagi straight away. That looked like a kick to me, and I know for a fact that the supervisors, the referee commission, will look carefully at that. They don't like the... don't like the amount of actual kicks as opposed to ashiwaza, which is sweep or reap. Difference between a kick and a reap and a sweep. Big difference when it hits your ankle, I can tell you.
Abulanze is unorthodox. I mean, he's not your typical Russian fighter, is he? No, he's... sorry, when we come to that point...
no, he's not, though. He isn't. He isn't. Yeah, right.
Okay, no. Forget, scrap that.
You confused me slightly then.
That's what happens when you look away.
Yeah, that's it. Well, he's got the grip that he wanted there, Garrigós, and, well, it was KR not prepared to kind of mix up there. He wanted to break away from it, felt danger.
These two have fought so hard today, it's difficult to separate them.
Yeah, I think, you know, for me, I'm the thing that impresses me about Garrigós is that he is a real grafter. You know, he's one of those that has, he knows that every time he steps out there, he's going to have to graft. And that it's all about the work. And he'll not stop coming forwards. And he'll perform in tachiwaza, newaza, and he'll keep at it. And that's what he keeps on doing. And he wears them down. That was very close, wasn't it? The mate had been called.
Yeah, visibly tiring. By
yeah,
the way,
no, yeah. He is, isn't he? And you can see as well that, I mean, he can perform some surprise techniques, and I think that's what he's relying on here. But this is where Garrigós wants to be. Likes that arm round the back. There's the change of direction, attacking both flanks.
Really busy. I mean, another cycle like that, and Kai is going to pick up a second penalty. He's got to start coming back into it and quickly.
I tell you now, he's not far off it, KR, because the work rate from Garrigós is immense, and every attack he does is good. The other thing you've got to look at as well, and you know, he didn't break his balance there, but it's intention. The intention there was to try and throw.
Yeah. And he did get him to block it.
Yeah.
Minute left to go. First of the attack again. Beautiful.
Wazari scored. And yeah. Garrigós, the work rate all paying off. And look at that. Attacking in Newaza. He just wants to get out of there, KR.
He just took his eye off the ball there. Big attack, Ochikari.
Yeah, just managed to turn there, didn't he, to prevent the ippon. And he likes that arm round the back. I mean, if it was me and he kept going for that, I'd just try and block it out, create a little bit of space maybe. There he is again, that big right arm of KR coming over, and it gives Garrigós his grip. Enforced drop there for Garrigós. Watch the change of direction from Garrigós. One flank and then the other side for the other one, the other flank.
Maybe Garrigós trying to keep Kaya out.
Yeah, there's a bit of that now, isn't there? 6 seconds to go, and gets the penalty for it.
Go now. Won't make any difference now. Too
no,
late.
It's all over.
A tough way to go for Kaya, I'm afraid. But Garrigós just had the beating of him here.
Yeah, it was a great tending. I mean, it was very, very near to Ippon, wasn't it? In as the, I mean, the credit to Kaya, managed to over rotate onto his shoulder to prevent it. But massive technique. We'll have a look at it in a second in slow motion. Break it down. That man there is a workhorse. He really is. He just never stops working.
So close. It's the worst thing to experience, to have to, you know, get to the semi-final and then end up with no medal.
Yeah, it is. It's a toughie, isn't it? You just go home and empty-handed. All that effort. But as I pointed out, Sheldon, another chance in about 3 weeks' time. Yeah. How good is that?
Still a fifth
I would
place
have loved
finish.
That. Look at that, just an overthrow there. But KR, that was the skill from him, really, because he just let it go. If he'd have just stopped, tried to stop it, and instead of going over with it, I think it would have been a clean Ippon. Arm round the back, Oguchi starts it off. Massive rotation, part of a hip movement as well.
Yeah, it ends up more like a hip throw, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it does.
End.
He just pushes that hips across. Surigosh, you know, almost. Ukigosh, should I say. Just half the hips making contact.
And just floats him over.
Yeah, he does.
The floating
hip. And he does
hip.
Float, doesn't he? He did float.
Fifth place finish for Walid Kaya. Really spirited effort. But it's Francisco Garrigós who ends up with the bronze medal. Very, very tough day. Well, here we are then. We come now to the final of the under 60 kilo category. Guzman Kyrgyzbaev of Kazakhstan faces Yago Abuladze, representing RJF. And let's have a look at their respective routes to this final. There's a look at the Kazakh fighter, Guzman Kyrgyzbaev.
Do you know, I'm just thinking about both these fighters coming out. Yeah, it could be a surprise. It's going to be a surprise, either one, really. Here's his first round match, Kyrgyzbaev.
David Pulkabek of the Czech Republic was his opponent.
Great opportunity for us to see their route through. And that was a very soft, almost score, but straight onto the arm for the Juji to get the Ippon.
Yeah, last 40 seconds of the contest, both fighters a little bit loose there. Pulkabek being guilty of not offering up any defense as they went to the ground.
No defense whatsoever.
Moritz Plavky of Germany gave me a little bit more of a go in round three.
Yeah, Plavky comes from different directions. Looks kind of almost relaxed sometimes. But look at this, arm over the top here, and he's going to take him backwards. Or again, the tip, as I like to call it. Plavky says, I'm not so sure about that, but definitely a score to take him through. Agvajamps, his next opponent there. Unbold Agvajamps of Mongolia. Big arm over the back again, so look out for that. Big sumageshi there, and that change of direction, scoring Ippon. Of course, this last one against KR of France. Nice, has the belt, massive pickup, change of direction, gets the Wazari. And that Wazari was in golden score, takes him through to this final. This man has had the most amazing run through. Every time I look to my right, something was happening. Abeladze against Buda, first fight.
Romarek Wendyam Buda of France was troubled by a foot injury on his left foot. That slowed him down a bit.
See the different lift he got there from that. It was a snaking Osoto, manages to get underneath and pop him up. Abek Ulu, his second or third round contest.
Yeah, the Kyrgyz man came unstuck here.
Wraps that, the arm up. Look at this hold down. Yeah, it's into the hold down here, and just flips the head back through here, and straight into the Yashiro, and just. It almost looks simple. Quarter final up against Gurchev. Same arm around the back here. Takes him back, changes the direction. Looking for the Newaza again, and he was looking for the Shimiwaza as well. There was Wazari enough, though. Semi-final.
Another Kazakh fighter, Magzan Shamshidin. He really does like it down on the ground.
Well, he does like it down on the ground. It was a mistake, wasn't it? That's for sure. Into the hold down, and that was him through. What a final. It's going to be unusual. It's going to be a clash of styles. And no matter what happens, it's going to be a new world champion. World ranked 11 and 9, respectively. Kyrgyzbeyev, the older of the two. Interesting, on their head-to-heads there, they've got one. 1-1. So they've matched up twice already. This is the third time.
Welcome the referee of this final, from the Republic of Korea,
Suk Hee Young of Korea, will be officiating this final.
And now, please welcome the finalists. In white, Judo, representing Kazakhstan, 2019 Abu Dhabi Grand winner. First time in a world.
I wonder what makes it seem like a much longer walk.
Yeah.
It's because there is only just, you know, there's just the one, either the fighter on his own or just the fighter and the coach, whereas you've normally got the cameraman around and a couple of people carrying out some stuff. You know, they make the area look a little bit more crowded. Now it looks like a lonely
trip. Walk out. That's what you're saying. It is.
Anyway, they'll be close enough soon.
Any second now. Final of the under 60 kilos category just about to get underway. New world champion going to be at the end of this contest.
Yes, absolutely. Guzman Kyrgyzbeyev in the white judogi, Yago Abuladze in blue. And as Neil said, the referee in the middle for this one is Hyun Suk Hee of the Republic of Korea. Now, I think I can say that Yago Abuladze is an unorthodox fighter. This is the right contest to talk about.
He's gone on to the arm again. He's going to pull the hold down arm. He went on to the arm and he just turned it. And he's got the hold down. Seconds ticking away there, and straight away he went in. Now then, Mate. Very close to the Wazari. Sorry, Sheldon.
No, not at all.
He was right onto the arm there, and he's been doing it all the way through.
And only the arm, just nothing else. He came close to scoring there. Kyrgyz Bayev was
panicking,
wriggling like a snake. There he goes again. And when you think it's finished, there's nothing there. He executes the roll.
Well, he wraps the arms up. He does a massive hip movement, unorthodox, because it comes in from a different angle. Then if it fails and they come off the wrong way, he keeps the arm and then turns in for the hold down. Brilliant.
You'll have to explain that one again.
I will do. As soon as we see it again, I'll explain. But he actually links the two together.
What do you think they're looking at here? For Wazari 4?
Well, we're going to have a look in a second. Okay. I'm not sure if it's for the time of the Osai Komi or the throw there.
I'm glad to have gotten out that bit about him being unorthodox, because he really is. He looks a little bit awkward.
He's very awkward. I tell you now, Abuladze, if you asked Kyrgyz Bayev, he'd say that he doesn't know where he's coming from. Look at that change of direction there. And he takes it back down. He scored Wazari again, and it's Wazeti Ipon, and new world champion. Did he make that look easy?
That's incredible.
Not breathing heavy.
No, not at all.
Wow.
He looked shell-shocked, Guzman Kyrgyz Bayev. What was that?
Well, I tell you, like I just said to you there, you know, if you asked him how awkward he was, like, and he was coming in, that arm was coming over very confident, and then he just came in for the Osoto, different angles, changed direction, corrected his balance every time.
No time to settle.
No time to settle. He knew he was going to do that. There's the change of direction. About three or four times he changed his direction and then just puts him onto his side.
You can see the agony on the face of Kyrgyz Bayev as he was going down, realizing, I can't get off this.
Well, I mean, he just wraps himself around that leg there. Kyrgyz Bayev, in the end, has to kind of half collapse. And the second Wazari there, he knew as soon as he came in for this Osoto that there was a possibility of a second Wazari. Brilliant, absolutely brilliant.
It was that slow motion slipping away. Here's my chance of the gold medal of the World Championships slipping away, and I don't understand what's happening here.
If you do Osoto to Osoto there, left to left, then one of them's going to go. And it's a dangerous thing attacking that front leg. But he readjusted his balance and he changed the direction. And, three times he changed it until in the end, his head was going forwards and he took him onto his side. A new world champion, and he's been magnificent all day. Diego Abuladze has... he's absolutely blasted himself to that world title.
We come now to the awarding ceremony for the women in the under 48 kilo category.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the medal ceremony for women under 48 kilo. The medals will be presented by the IOC member and former president of Hungary, Mr. Schmidt-Wahl.
He's the former president of Hungary, Mr. Schmidt-Pahl, who's presenting the medals. The first of the bronze medals goes to Munkhbat Urensetsek of Mongolia.
Still there after all this time and still winning medals at major, major tournaments.
There's a bronze medal also for Julio Figueroa of Spain.
Silver medals representing Japan, Kota
silver medal goes to Koga Wakana of Japan.
Yeah, silver medal in the World Championship, senior, junior world champion, of course, she was. Great performance.
But the gold medal goes to Tsunoda Natsumi of Japan.
What a performance. Just blasted her way to this world title. Three arm locks, three kensetsu for Ippon, and then throwing as well. Brilliant Tomonagis, brilliant technique all the way through. Whenever the newaza didn't work, she was there with the tachiwaza. What a performance. Olympic Games not far away, and some of these won't be there. Certainly the two Japanese fighters, first and second, will not be competing in Tokyo.
Ladies and gentlemen, please all rise for the national anthem of Japan.
And now the national anthem of Japan. Moments, I suppose, for any of the fighters when it's all over. They've got the medal around the neck, prize money's in there. All they've got left to do now is, well, I suppose, the
celebrate
doping, and then the the press interviews at the end.
Yeah, no, it's. I remember, you know, you step up there, and it's just the greatest feeling. End of a hard day's work.
I'll take your word for it. Yeah, pleased for all of them. Yulia Figueroa, Munk Bator and Setseg. Koga Wakana, I mean, she's got plenty of time, hasn't she? She's so young, she's only 19. And then if you really consider that this is the back end of Tsunoda Natsumi's career, what a way
to go out.
You're not going to be at the Tokyo Olympics, but you are world champion.
She'll go out as the current world champion.
Yeah.
And with a performance par excellence. I mean, Ippon, absolutely every match.
That was a quality performance from Tsunoda. Really enjoyed watching that. And we're about to come now to the awarding ceremony for the men in the under 60 kilo category. Some of the highlights from earlier today. Hussainov already suggesting that his next job after the fighter will be as a referee, giving the Wazari score as he was on the ground there.
Is that what he said?
He didn't only give the signal, he mouthed it as well. You know? We're always looking for new referees. That's a good start for you. Garrigos and Walid Kaya, they gave us a lot of action. There was a lot of to-ing and fro-ing there, and all of a sudden, Garrigos was able to find that other gear to push things up and force Walid Kaya to open up.
Just never stop coming forward, Garrigos, and brilliant stuff. Here we go with the medal ceremony of the men's under 60 kilograms category.
The medals are being presented by Mr. Yevgeny Kuvashev, who is the governor of the Sverdlovsk region, where we normally have the Ekaterinburg Grand Slam.
Oh, of course, yes.
If I remember rightly.
He's the man that we've just been talking about and never stops coming forwards. Great work,
Garrigos. It is. Sorry, who picks up his bronze medal, and there is Karamat Hussainov. You've done a terrific job there. No one expected him to be up and around the medals. Silver medal goes to Guzman Kyrgyzbaev, who was almost, we could call it ambushed, if you like, by the gold medal winner, Iago Abuladze.
Yeah, no doubt in this this young man here, the world champion, and he did it in a way that you all want to do it, you know, Ippon all the way.
Prize money is being presented by the International Judo Federation ambassador, Vasily Anisimov. Look at that, he's up to date and current, the old fist pump. Look at that. Given a glass of champagne by Mr. Anisimov one evening. Oh, he'd go for the handshake anyway, yeah. That's Mr. Abuladze. What a moment.
Well, what a moment for him, but I mean, you just looked at his face and you knew that he expected it.
He did not look surprised. You're quite right.
I think often it is the difference. People come out and they're absolutely sure about that day, and it's all going to come together. And for him,
oozing confidence.
Going to be a threat as well. You know, I'm not sure actually whether he is going to the Olympics or not.
No, I don't know. And I mean, I thought that they had already selected Robert Shvedabadze.
Well, this does give them time to come back into the middle, and it's all about being pals just for a little while anyway.
your applause to our judo Prix, man under 60 kilo.
There's the final table. Garrigos and Huseynov were the bronze medal winners. Kyrgyzbayev picked up the silver, but it was Yago Aboladze who collected the gold medal. Congratulations to all of them. And that actually really was a fascinating day of super lightweight judo. Not always the case. Not trying to give you the hard sell here, but today was really, really good day.
It was a fantastic first day, lightest weight categories. Really delivered, and you can see there medal count: Japan one gold, one silver, and then of course the Russian Judo Federation there with one gold, Kazakhstan one silver, and Spain there with two bronze medals. So Mongolia on there as well with a bronze medal. They're the first five countries. It's all going to change, of course. It over the 7 days changes all the time. We've had an absolutely great time with you. We'll be back at the same time tomorrow. From Sheldon and I, it's bye for now.
Welcome in our live studio here for a recap of day one here at the World Championships in Budapest. Me and Loretta, we will discuss what we've seen today, and we've seen some excellent judo. World champion for Japan, and of course also gold medal for the Russian Judo Federation. Loretta, let's start with the 48 kilograms.
Right, well, it was definitely a showdown, wasn't it? We were at the bronze medal matches. We had a real battle between the number one and number two seed, Krasniqi, and also Monkbat. A little bit disappointing, really, at the final outcome for me, for Krasniqi, when it actually came that she looked like she was trying to steal it rather than win it. It was the massive mistake that she made of the whole day. Her great performance throughout her journey to that bronze medal match, and sadly let herself down, I personally feel, right in that bronze medal match.
Yeah, because she won she lost with the Shidos, and she tried to show the referee that Munkbat was trying to hold down the sleeve, but it was, in my opinion, it was a normal situation. Munkbat just controlled the sleeve, but not like really obvious or something, and she just tried to steal this bronze medal.
Yes, exactly. That's exactly what was happening. You could see that there was a controlling of the sleeve, but that wasn't a negative control. It wasn't a sort of pushing towards her opponent, but Krasniqi tried to play on it. And she played on it a couple of times, and the referee wasn't having any of it the first time he saw that. But the second time, she still didn't learn by the mistake, and then got that third and final Shido and lost the bronze medal. It was disappointing, and I'm sure when she reflects back of what happened, she will see the mistakes, a massive mistake she made, and went home without taking a medal here today.
So we had Figueroa from Spain, who won the other bronze medal with a really strong fighting today. And then we had a Japanese final, of course, with Tsunoda. Well, I've seen some arm locks there and some Tomoe Nage's. She was in absolutely top form, and also in the final, in my opinion, she was overclassing her Japanese rival.
Well, definitely. There was 10 years of maturity there. And I think in that final, that's exactly what we saw. The maturity of the young lady that came in. With both of these athletes and their performance throughout the whole day, what was inevitable, their success came from that transition. The ability to be able to change direction, the variety of standing tachiwaza techniques that they had, but also the transition, the smooth transition into niwaza.
Well, if we talk about transition, we saw somebody who absolutely is a king in transitions whole day, and that was the gold medalist from the Russian Judo Federation, Abulazi. He was whole day, he was so strong with his techniques, his standing techniques, but then on the ground, wrapping up the arm, using the leg, throwing his opponents around, and then just grab them in the Osai Komis. I think he did it like three or four times. Also in the final, very fast, winning a Wazari. I think it's maybe, it's 26 years ago that the last Russian, 60 kilogram Russian, won the world championship. That was Oyeguin. If you're into judo, just look it up. Not even a real good fight, but also with the best mustache ever I've ever seen in the whole judo tour. But so it's so long time ago that they had a world championships in the world champion in the 60 kilogram category. But they won the Olympics in 2016, and they won the Olympics in 2012, and now. What I've heard, if Abulazi win the world championships today, then maybe there is a big chance for him to go to the Olympics. And if he's in this form, then I think for sure he is capable of winning a medal there.
Definitely. I totally agree with everything you've said there. When you watched him perform throughout the day, it was a snake-like reactions. He didn't grip. He wrapped his whole body around his opponents every time. The arms wrapped around his opponents' arms. The legs wrapped around for the Ouchigaris and the Osotogaris. All wrapped around. And his flexibility and movement and direction was second to none. And that transition was superb.
Yeah, I would love that if you see the technique that Abulazi made during the whole day, the Neiwaza technique, just try it out. If you're in your judo club, that's something you can really try out because it's a brilliant technique. He is the world champion. We had the European champion, Garrigós from Spain. He won a bronze medal. Nagayama. Yesterday we spoke like, who do you think will be the world champion? And we both said, well, I said Abulazi, let's see. But Nagayama, he was the biggest name for everybody. But he went out against... Yes, a little bit. Just did it like this. Everybody was saying like, no, Nagayama will win for sure. I said, well, maybe Abulazi has also a chance. But Nagayama out against Khusainov. For me, it's really nice that Khusainov won a bronze medal because, of course, Nagayama was the biggest name today. And then if you throw out the biggest name and then still in the end will turn out without the medal, that's a shame. But Khusainov won the bronze medal and in a really strong way, I think.
Yes, he definitely did. And I think with Khusainov, he sealed his place for the Olympic Games as well. So also, although he's got a bronze medal, I think he's actually got that plane ticket to Tokyo. And there was two Azerbaijans in that weight category. His opponent, his teammate went out in the first round. So I think after that, when you watched him fight, he fought Nagayama in that second round, I think. And for me, he destroyed Nagayama. And it was like painful to watch. It was something like when we had discussed yesterday and who we felt was the strongest athlete, who had everything to want this gold medal, you would have said Nagayama, because he wasn't selected for Japan for the Olympic Games. He had everything to fight for. He had a great opportunity to take center stage. He was the number one seed as well. And then it just all went horribly wrong. And we thought that this was going to be a trend there for Huseynov. But after that win, he tend to sort of nosedive a little bit and lost out to another opponent, and which was quite disappointing. But I think at that moment he had his mind on different things. He'd realized his teammate had gone out in that first round. He'd already got his plane ticket, and somewhere along the line he forgot he was actually fighting for the world title.
Well, it was a bronze medal though for him, so that's absolutely, of course, a good medal for him, his first medal at the World Championships. Let's look at tomorrow, the second day, because yesterday we discussed about who's going to win, and we did it before, so now let's do it on camera, because we have, of course, Maruyama, and let's be honest, he's one of the absolutely top players, not at the Olympics, it will be Abe. I think everybody remembers this 20 minutes fight between Maruyama and Abe at the Olympics. Maruyama, I think the best chance of winning the gold medal, but there's another guy. He's really good. He's from Europe. He's from Italy. And he's your favorite.
I've got loads of favorite. You've just put me right on the spot.
That's what you said yesterday. And Lombardo, and if
I think he's it for me, over the sort of years that I've watched him from a very young athlete, I think he has grown in confidence, and he has that ability and that flexibility. He just seems to be oozing, and I think this is a chance here to prove himself. And he's one of my favorites. I think he's a beautiful technician. He's got style about him, and there's just something, he's got that X factor for me.
Well, and it's not a strange thing to say, because Lombardo is a really good fighter. And if there's one fighter tomorrow that can beat Maruyama, it's Lombardo. It can also be Mark Velashvili from Georgia. The old fox, Santaraya, he's still there with loads of medals already at the World Championships. Let's see if he can win another one. Tal Flicker from Israel. And then we have, of course, the Russians, Shamilov, Shopanov, they're both fighting here. So let's see if they're capable of winning a medal. And then in the 52 kilogram category, I think there's one real big name, also from Japan, it's Shishime. Yeah,
I think after what we've seen, a run of success there for Japan, I think this will roll on till tomorrow. I think that's sort of going to boost that team, and I think we will see some really good performance there again for Japan. But we have from Great Britain, we have Chelsea Giles. And
of course, I was waiting for it. Where are the Great Britons?
Yeah. Oh, definitely. This is a young lady we have to watch out for. She has had some really good performances throughout the past couple of years. And again, this confidence is boosting. The timing's just right for her. And we're oozing forward towards the Olympic Games.
Okay, but do you have to give the same amount of credits to Chelsea Giles as Lombardo? Maybe that's a little bit too much. I think some other really great athletes are there tomorrow. Gneto, of course, from France. Cohen, Chelsea Giles. I wrote it down. And of course, Van Snick from Belgium. Let's see what tomorrow will bring. The second day here at the World Championships is the men under 66 kilograms and the women under 52 kilograms. Tomorrow we will start at 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock.
10 o'clock.
So see you then. Bye-bye.